So today I want to talk about something you've probably seen in the news every now and then. It's the so-called the brain-eating amoeba. It's a pretty scary sounding name, right? And as a matter of fact, it is, because just recently in June 2025, it's just a few weeks ago, as of the making of this video here, an 11-year-old boy from Slovakia, it's a country in Europe, he died after swimming in a thermal pool, and the cause was an infection by this brain-eating amoeba. So no wonder the media reports about that. So hi, hello and welcome again. Microbehunter here. I'm Oliver. I like to put things under the microscope, but every now and then I would like to make a video about some of the microorganisms that are surrounding us. And today I decided to talk a little bit about this brain-eating amoeba, which seems to be pretty commonly reported on in the media. As a matter of fact, not only nowadays, but even back in the 1960s, there was a large outbreak in the United States when a crack in a public swimming pool allowed for a contamination. So evidently some of those brain-eating amoeba were actually growing in the crack, and a lot of people died. Well, 16 people died back in 1960s, so no wonder the name has been sticking around since that time. But the question is now is how worried should you actually be? Right. So what I always think is let's take a step backwards. Let's look at the whole thing a little bit more objectively here, and at a couple of statistics. Well, despite those tragic cases, there are fewer than 10 cases reported worldwide each year of that infection. And there are millions of people who are swimming in lakes, rivers, and pools, and also hot tubs and hot baths. So yes, so while these cases are real, they are extremely, extremely rare. Right. So what is now this amoeba? Well, there is a scientific name to that organism. It's difficult to pronounce. Naegleria fowleri, it's called. And it's a type of a protozoan. This basically means it's a single-celled organism that lives in warm freshwater environments, in lakes, hot springs, and even in poorly maintained swimming pools. It's a eukaryote, so this means that it's not a bacterium. The cell structure, therefore, is in that sense similar to our own body cell structure, in that there is a nucleus present and other cell organelles. Don't want to go off too much into biology here now. Now, this is now where it gets interesting and also a little bit dangerous, because it is possible to become infected, and this happens when water enters the nose, usually when you're diving into the pool or when you're playing around in this warm water. And when you're getting the water into the nose with the amoeba in it, then the amoeba travels up the so-called olfactory nerve to the brain. Now, and that's the nerve that connects the nose to the brain. And that's basically the road or the path that how it's able to reach the brain. And when it actually settles in the brain, then it's able to cause a disease called primary amoebic meningoencephalitis. Long name, therefore it's commonly abbreviated as PAM, P-A-M. And sadly, that's the sad thing here, it's almost always fatal. So no cure or anything. Now, the incubation period, that's the time from infection until the first symptoms, is usually around 5 days, but it's possible that it's a little bit shorter or longer. And the early symptoms are usually a headache, fever, nausea, so you feel ill, you get a stiff neck. But those look like many other common illnesses. And that's actually one part of the problem, because it's hard and difficult to catch early. And by the time that it's diagnosed, it's often too late. And while there are apparently some treatments, there is absolutely no guaranteed cure. And in many cases, it's fatal. Now, let's put that a little bit into perspective with what I do, because I work with microscopes all the time, and amoeba are pretty much very common in water samples that I find. The most actually very common single-celled organisms that you can find in the water samples. And I often spot them moving around on my microscope slide, feeding on bacteria, doing their own thing, totally harmless, and I like to observe them and simply watch them and what they do. I even have a slime mold, which I keep as a pet, and really this is actually made of cells that move around like an amoeboid manner, changing their shape. And as a matter of fact, I think even the whole slime mold behaves almost like a gigantic cell. And these organisms are very fascinating and totally benign, so they're completely harmless. But the moment people hear the word amoeba, all they think about is this brain-eating amoeba here, and this kind of creates a mental bias where an entire group of organisms is associated just with one dangerous example. It's a little bit like hearing the word shark. And then people are thinking almost automatically of the great white shark of the movies, which are going to bite you. Basically they categorize, make a bigger category of simply one individual, which is dangerous. And that's basically also the problem with this amoeba over here, because this amoeba lives in warm water, and especially during the summer times. But and that's important. You cannot get it simply by swallowing the water. You have to inhale it through your nose, and this is how it's able to reach the brain. Now the question is, now should you be afraid? Statistically seen, no, right? Because the risk is incredibly low of catching it. So if you're swimming around in water, in natural water, there are actually way more common dangers, like, for example, bacterial infections, parasites, even just drowning is way more common. Actually, these are the things that you should be mindful of or afraid of. So, and I think I consider it interesting because it's kind of a nice example how risk perception works, because people tend to fear the unknown, or they tend to fear things that they feel that they cannot control. But when it comes to smoking, speeding on the highway, or alcohol consumption, now people do those things all the time because they think that they are more in control of it, and these activities are also more familiar to them, even though they are actually, you know, quite likely to kill you or to harm your health, right? And now this Naegleria fowleri amoeba here, it sounds terrifying, and the media loves, of course, the media loves a good headline. But what I want to say, a little bit simplified, if you already want to be afraid of something, right, at least be afraid of the things that actually matter and the things that actually pose a realistic threat. And while this infection is very dangerous, it's not very common. So should you not panic about swimming, but you know, I know psychology does play a role, and if you're in a warm freshwater environment and you feel uneasy swimming there, just use a nose clip or avoid forceful diving. It can give you kind of a peace of mind, maybe. It's not something that you should do or need to do, given how rare the infections are. But honestly, if you feel more comfortable, why not just take those precautions, right? Because even sometimes small actions can ease a worry, even if the actual risk is incredibly low. Yeah, but I have to admit, low risk does not mean zero risk. And nowadays, with the temperature in many bodies of waters increasing because of climate change and so on, yeah, of course, maybe we're going to see in the future also a higher incidence of these infections. Well, first of all, thank you for listening. If you like these fact-based videos here, and then of the microscopic world of microorganisms, I would like to invite you, of course, to subscribe to this channel. There's so many more things to explore, and scary and not so scary things. I'll think of new topics in the future. So for today, that's all I would like to share with you. Happy microbe hunting as always, and see you around in the next video. Bye bye.